Welcome to the Sports Circus from Fabulous Las Vegas. I'm your Ringmaster Sal here with Long Beach Lenny and Colonel Bucky. Today's show is brought to you by the American Business Trust Company, specializing in startup consulting, sales and marketing, corporate strategy, and investment capital. Visit them at abtrustco.com or call 657-600-1876. That's abtrustco.com, 657-600-1876. Tell them the circus sent you. All right, a big welcome to everybody listening in on our NBC Sports studios, our NBC Sports stations from coast to coast, as well as iHeartRadio, and we're right here at SB Nation, KMZQ 670, The Score in fabulous Las Vegas. Lenny, what's cracking?
Hey, man, doing good, my friend. I'll tell you what's cracking. How about we crack off a little bit of tension in hockey that happened the other night, Sal?
All right.
How about the Calgary Flames in Detroit? Squaring off with one another, man. It wasn't just a one-on-one, man. It was like every man for himself.
Hey, man.
Beautiful thing.
What happened to your Queens? I mean, Kings.
Oh, that would be on the off-the-radar, nobody-cares report.
No, everybody cares about it.
Everybody cares over here about that one, you bet.
Everybody cares. Because they were beat by the Vegas Golden Knights.
As Colin Frazier would say, and that was a real snoozer, eh? All right.
No,
we really don't have any fear of the expansion team coming. Good for them. I'm glad that Vegas is representing, honestly, because it's
no, you're
an expansion
not.
Team. We don't want them to be garbage. You know, we really don't. I mean, we don't want them to,
but come on, Fairweather fan. Don't abandon your Kings right now. What are you doing?
You know who I want to be garbage. The absolute one I want to be garbage is tonight, San Jose beating up the Ducks. That's really the thing that matters. As long as the Ducks are in the rearview mirror, the Kings make the playoffs. Look, we've proven that we could be an eighth seed and we could take the cup,
We.
So it really doesn't matter.
What do you mean we? So what you're saying is you play for the Kings? You said we.
Anybody who is a fan, Sal, and the
just because
part of
you're
fan
a
is from,
fan is, doesn't mean you're part of the team.
Look up the word, okay? Fan is shortened for fanatic. If you're fanatic about your team, I think you have a little bit of heart in the game, some skin as a fan. You live and die with them. Or should we not mention your White Sox?
Hey, don't worry about the. This has nothing to do with the White Sox. It has everything to do with your Queens.
My Kings are going to be okay. And by the way, he who needs glasses, why don't you look on the internet as Captain, Bucky Peck goes and looks it up to see who's still on top of formerly known as the Smythe Division. It would be the Kings.
Well, Captain Bucky Peck wants to say hello. What do you mean, Captain Bucky Peck?
He never has anything good to say.
Well,
so,
he's just calling you a pecker. Come on, man.
You know, I watched that game yesterday.
Yeah?
And I was thinking of Lenny.
Pretty excited with your home team.
The first thing I was thinking of, I saw the Knights were up 3-0. I said, I can't wait until they win this game so I can just rub it into Lenny when we get on the show. So now is that very moment right now. So,
hey, bud, what's your problem?
Right there.
Exactly. Yeah, so guess what? God they didn't blow it, though. They didn't blow it.
No,
oh, man. I know. It was 3-0, and then it's 3-2. And then the net is empty. And then there was panic in front of the four-string goalie. Thank God Legacy is going to be going out. And finally, Malcolm Subban comes back. The second stringer comes back. The funny part about that is that our first stringer magically signed a contract for $6 million. And guess what? He played a few games. And now he's gone. He got himself a concussion. Now he has an excuse not to come back. You know, and I sent the Golden Knights a message on that saying, so was that a PR stunt to get us to buy 5 years of season tickets? Apparently it worked.
Apparently it did.
Apparently it worked. But guess what? They're only 1 point and 2 games in hand against your blasted Queens.
See, there you go. Yours. See, I'm glad you said that. They are mine. All right.
Yeah, but they're yours. That doesn't mean you play for them.
Look, anytime that we have a cup that we have won. Oh wait,
we. There's that we again. That we have won. You haven't won any cup. The only cup you have is the one that's protecting your parts down low.
The Those are fortified and certified.
Hey, this is a family show, by the way. So, listen, this is a family show. We've got a couple of family members in here, so you're going to have to watch yourself today, bud.
I'll watch myself. And then here's Bucky. Bucky's almost like when he's trying to do a dig on me. I was waiting all weekend after the Kings lost to get on the radio and tell Lenny, nanner, 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 all right?
Well, this is what he's got to say to you.
Better than that. There it is.
You're down for the count.
Knights over the Kings.
That's right. And mind you, it's only a one-point difference, only one, and the Golden Knights have two games in hand. Bad news for your Queens, kid. They're going down.
Who was ahead again? I couldn't get 1 point ahead. Okay, that's what I wanted to.
Yes, we have two of them.
That. Who?
Yes, we have two of them. Please proceed.
You said we have two of them. All right. I just wanted to
figure it out. Come on, Charlie. It's Monday.
I know. You know what? Hey, that's good. Now, look, I am. You know, on this show, I've always said it's good for the circus. It's good for Vegas that there is a team that's excelling, a pro team over there. And I hope that everything goes well. I hope that they get the football team over there, and I hope everything goes well with them. You need to have Vegas to be relevant. It's a good story. It's a good story to have some up-and-coming team to do well.
You say for Vegas to be relevant. Like Vegas is irrelevant? It's the most relevant. Listen, this is the entertainment capital of the world, buddy. You know it's relevant. It's always relevant. On a Tuesday afternoon, it's relevant.
They're not relevant in the sports world right now, okay? That's what I'm saying.
Yes, they are. They have two games in hand on the Queens. Guess what's going to happen, kid? You know what? Hey, listen, real quick. Let's give an update on that that hockey brawl. Remember the brawl we had last week? So the
Calgary and the Red Wings.
Right, right. So the Calgary player, I forget his name. Who was the guy in Calgary?
Was it Matthew?
It's escaping me. Anyway, so he gets
a one or something like that.
So he gets a one game suspension. That's fine. And the guy from Detroit, end up getting 10 games. You know why he got 10 games, by the way? He got 10 because he went to the bench and then he came back on the ice. And as soon as you do that, doesn't matter what the context is, 10 games. And there you have it. And so Detroit was complaining.
Was the guy?
He was the guy that was getting pummeled. He was the guy that was getting pummeled. He got the stick up his backside and then he came back on the ice just so he could fight, and he got pummeled on top of it. But at the same time, we ended up with a 10-game suspension. He did, nonetheless.
Who did? We did? He did?
Oh, knock it off.
Trying to figure
that's
out.
That's enough out of you, mister.
Vocabulary there, sir.
And by the way, the Blackhawks did beat the Rangers over the weekend, and they did also have another nice victory, and that was against whom? Who was that? Anybody chime in?
Was it the sounds of silence. In first place in their division?
The sounds of silence.
Who was it?
I believe that was against the Pittsburgh Penguins. Yeah, your other bandwagon club that you like to jump onto.
Kid Crosby.
I got your Kid Crosby. There's your Kid Crosby.
How about doing us all a favor, Sal? And when you talk about Subban, and you're not mentioning the goalie for the Vegas Golden Knights. You're not mentioning it by his name. You say, and our first-string goalie, who happens to have two Stanley Cups.
Oh, who cares? He's washed up. He was washed up last year, the year before. Get out of here. He didn't even play in the Cup, really, last year. It was Murray's team.
He contributed.
You're right. He gave up a lot of goals. You're right.
Look at you.
I am looking
seriously.
At me. Knock it off, mister. Hey, listen. Okay, so next segment, we're going to have a special guest on next segment. Hopefully he shows up. Also, we've got a student athlete or two here in the house, and we'll let them introduce themselves on the way out coming up, in about maybe 2.5 minutes or so. All right, Lenny, take us out of here.
All right, so what do we got, Bucky?
10 seconds.
It's killing us. All right, so ladies and gentlemen, you're just getting started on the Sports Circus. We will be back with a few special guests and more mayhem. Don't go anywhere.
Big B
Billy here, he certainly knows something about making things difficult on the competition.
He's a punisher.
Yeah, he just break the ribs.
Yeah, just,
you know, I still haven't broke someone's collarbone yet in a boxing match, and that's my goal. I want to put somebody in the shoulder.
There's time, Bronco.
I want to put somebody in the shoulder.
You got your bucket list over here of pain.
Yeah, bucket list of pain.
I haven't broken somebody's collarbone. I've broken everything else.
Which reminds me, I was thinking the reason he probably doesn't wear anything when it's cold outside is he figures he'll just grab some nerd and squeeze him real hard and squeeze the warmth out of him.
Squeeze the warmth out of him. That's a great statement. I have not broke someone's collarbone in the ring yet.
I've never heard that before.
I have not. I can't wait.
Is there a reason you said in the ring?
I can't wait.
Is it that you've broken collarbones just outside of the ring?
You did catch that, right? He said in the ring.
Yeah, exactly. He got him on the curtain. He got him on the edge of the ring and broke his collarbone.
I had to get Sal's name right.
Well, that never happened.
Sal the floor sweeper. That's his new name.
Sal the bookkeeper.
But even my name, even my last name.
Add that one to the bank, you know?
But no, Alicia, you even got my last name wrong. That's why I said my
name. I know it starts with a V. It starts with a V.
He said a V. Really? Where's the punch sound? 400 punches.
Here's the punch sound.
Right. Look, he almost knocked out the microphone.
Alicia, that's why they have cue cards, baby. That's what that, you know. So don't let the name bother you. Just bring a cue card with you next time.
But people can't read my name off a cue card.
Or change your name to Joe Smith or something. Jeez, make it easy.
Yeah.
Because the concept on that was that during I throw a flag downfield for DPI, so
how
to speak.
How far could you throw a flag? What's your record for throwing a flag?
Well, you know what people don't realize.
I know there's beanbags or something.
There's beanbags, marks the spots. It flags, you've got a little sand in it too, and you roll it up to a little ball to try to get to the
record?
Spot. You don't. People think that you're throwing it a huge distance. You don't have to throw it a huge distance. You just got to get it on the right line.
But do they have like a punt passing kick for flags?
No, but you can throw it 15, 20, 22 yards pretty easy. You know, you can throw it pretty good to get it to the spot.
Have you ever thrown a flag at a player out of frustration?
No. I'll tell you what I did do. Years ago, when I was in high school ball, we used to wear the flag in our back pocket. Most officials wear it down in the front. No. Yeah, and I went to throw the flag, and at that time, we didn't have all the official supplies like you have now. I used to go to the hardware store and get a fishing weight to put in the yellow flag.
Went to the hardware store.
Yeah.
Fishing weight.
Imagine how old
you
I am.
You can see how well the NFL really pays well, don't they?
So I had this weight in my flag, and it was in the back, and I was on the wing, and I went to throw it, and it got caught in the back of my pants, and I swung it. Swung it like this, and it went across, hit the kid in the helmet. Kid looked at me and said, "Now, don't go off sides again." You know, you got to try to cover yourself. But as you guys know, years ago.
But the goofiest thing that we ever did was they filled a swimming pool full of Jell-O, and people could pay to watch Gary and I dive into this pool of Jell-O, and he and I raised $100,000 doing that.
That's hilarious.
That was the goofiest thing I've ever done.
I love that. And you know, at least when you go underwater, you can actually eat Jell-O.
That's right. That's right.
Can you actually swim in Jell-O?
You actually could, because it's so soft in texture that you actually could.
That's ridiculous.
That's funny. Jesus. Probably the craziest Bill Parcells moment was one day we were getting our butts kicked. I think it was might have been Philadelphia. We came in at halftime, and the room was quiet. The room was stoked quiet. Guys were mad. You know, what's going on? And Parcells comes in the locker room, and he has a garbage can full of garbage. And he takes the garbage can, and he dumps it in the middle of the meeting at halftime. And the guys look at each other, and we go, "What the hell is that about?" The next thing you know, because that's what you guys are playing like. And I might as well leave you right there with it. But that was a quietly kept Parcellsism.
Please visit www.thesportscircus.com for a complete list of featured guests and previous episodes.
You're listening to The Sports Circus, and I'm Mike Golick.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. Colonel Bucky here, along with Sal, the Ringmaster. Of course, Long Beach Lenny over there in Southern California. We do want to say hi to everybody listening to us on all our NBC sports stations across the country. Also, iHeartRadio, and of course, our home base right here in Las Vegas, AM 670, The Score, SB Nation. This segment is brought to you by the Black Diamond PR Firm, representing actors, athletes, authors, musicians, and small businesses since 2007. You know, everything you do is public relations. It is. Black Diamond PR Firm, we are your people. Now, do yourself a favor. Visit them right now, blackdiamondfirm.com. That's blackdiamondfirm.com. If you're an aspiring actor, athlete, author, musician, blackdiamondfirm.com. Or call 877-256-3075. And we are back officially. All right.
Bucky, did you welcome everybody back?
I did.
You did?
I did indeed.
All right, I was out to lunch. I didn't hear anything. All right, I'm your Ringmaster Sal. Back here with Long Beach Lenny, that was Colonel Bucky, and I'm not going to welcome everybody back because he said he already did.
There it is.
All right, and we're not doing Facebook Live today either.
No, usually we do, but we've got a full studio in here.
There's five people in a half a studio today.
You got some people here from back east.
Right. As a matter of fact, we got a couple of students, student athletes, et cetera, in here. And why don't you introduce yourself?
Hi, I am Dominic Tuzzolino, a sophomore at Frem High School in the northwest suburbs.
What do you play?
I play baseball and basketball.
All right. Are you any good?
I'd like to say so.
I'd like to say so. All right, give him a round of applause. Hold on. Give him that one. Hold on. There's an audience, sorry. They're still applauding you. All right, and yourself?
I'm John Tuzzolino. I'm a sophomore at the University of Illinois.
Nice. What are you studying?
I'm studying molecular and cellular biology.
Wow. What do you hope to do?
I kind of want to go into research right now, but you know, I'll figure it out once I get my diploma. That's the most important thing.
Are you John Jr.?
I am, yeah.
Well, that would mean we have John Sr. here. Come over here, John Sr., and say hello. Come over here. Hurry up. Here, put these on and introduce yourself.
How's it going, sports family out there? I'm Sal's first cousin from Chicago, and I'm happy to be here. Thank you.
There he is. All right, now it's the sounds of silence. All right, so hey, tell you what, Lenny, did our special guest pop in just yet?
No, I didn't hear him just yet, but what was the youngest Tuzzolino in the studio there?
Hi, I'm Dominic Tuzzolino.
Hey, Dominic, let me just give you a little tutoring here, okay? When Sal or anybody else asks you, hey, kid, are you any good when you sports? Your answer should be yes.
Brad Stevens is the real reason. Kyrie and, you know, the Kyrie, Hayward, and Horford, they all fit into the system. They go out in the draft, pick Tatum, also get a first-round pick out of that, too, trading down from 1-3. And Jaylen Brown's progressions really impressed me, too.
You know, I was wondering your thoughts about Brad Stevens because he did – I mean, he had great success at Butler in the college game. And, you know, a lot of times it doesn't work when the college coach goes to the pros. You know, the players, they may not respond to him. But Brad Stevens, it's taken a couple of years, but he's really taken that next step. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, yeah, wholeheartedly, yeah.
Yeah, no doubt about that. And it doesn't hurt to have Kyrie – on your team as well. And I think Kyrie has had an opportunity since he's not with LeBron right now. He's been able to show his skills in the passing game, especially where he didn't really have that opportunity when he was playing with Cleveland.
Well, yeah. When you have the opportunity to go out and get, you know, a perennial all-star NBA world champion at age 25, you gotta get him. Like you have to get him. And that's obvious, you know, it showed all the positives. They've reaped all benefits so far. And, you know, the big thing about going from college to the pros, for Brad Stevens at least, is what I see is he focuses on being one team. And in the NBA, you see a lot of guys go out and, you know, they all want, you know, they're all about their individual talent. You know, they want to get the biggest contract possible. But Brad Stevens really does look like he takes all the pieces that Danny Ainge gets for him, and he really does gel them together, and they have a lot of chemistry already, and they're 17 right. games into the season.
Right.
So, you know, it's just really impressive seeing Brad Stevens get all these 20- and 30-year-olds together. You know, you have Al Horford, you know, 30-year-old power forward, and he's out there mentoring Jason Tatum and Jaylen Brown, 19- and a 20-year-old. And it's crazy to see that Brown and Tatum are taking over the games. They've had multiple comebacks from like 16, 17 points down, and Tatum and Brown are the two that shine in those situations.
Now, from the beginning of the season, you look at Cleveland and Boston, and I'm just wondering, you know, Boston, of course, I think is the biggest threat to Cleveland getting back to the finals. Wouldn't you agree?
Oh, yeah, 100%. I mean, you can see it right now. Cleveland was, you know, they were ninth in the standings a couple days ago. Celtics are first.
So, hey, I've got a I want to make a quick introduction. So we have our NBA correspondent, Theo Ratliff, on the line with us as well. And now, you know, Theo did. Hey, Theo, what's going on, buddy?
Hey, what's going on, man? What's going on over there on the big show?
All right. Well, we got a couple of young men in here, and one is a really big Celtics fan. I know you wore that Celtics jersey before, along with some of the others. And I think John here may have a question for you.
Okay, cool.
Sure.
I know, yeah, he's excited right now.
He's on a roll. He's talking about the Celtics. He's panicking right now. Like, I don't have a question. I don't know what to say.
Yeah, how are you feeling about the Celtics this year? What do you think their chances are?
Oh, man, the Celtics, I mean, they're the big surprise, you know, in the NBA right now. Especially with Gordon Hayward going down the way he went down the first 50 seconds of the game, or the first game, and having an all-star of that caliber that was just steady growing in his play and in his stature in the NBA, lose a guy like that, you know, those young guys have stepped up tremendously. Tatum and what's my other guy name?
Jaylen Brown.
Jaylen. Tatum and Jaylen has stepped all the way up in Smart. I mean, I think he's like that glue down. Smart is like that glue on the offensive end and the defensive end. He's definitely grown in the game and understand how to pick and choose when to score, when to create. And he's just a guy that creates a whole lot of havoc out on the floor. And their defense is second to none right now. And I think that's what's really putting them over the top. And then you got Kyrie Irving just coming in and showing his leadership ability of being able to do what he's done, you know, even when he was in Cleveland with LeBron, is make those big shots in the fourth quarter and win games for you. And that's what he's shown, even though – sometimes he's shot the ball very well and scored a lot, but most of the time when it comes in the fourth quarter, he's always the guy that's taking the big shots or creating the offense in order to help the team win. And that's why they're on the road that they're on, because they have such a guy like that, and you have role guys that are willing to play in that role and let him be that guy.
Hey, Theo, for everybody that doesn't know who you are, introduce yourself and give everybody a quick background on yourself.
Yeah, Theo Ratliff, former NBA player, retired 2011. Last team was the Lakers. Played 16 years in the NBA, drafted to Detroit Pistons in 1995. Went on, played 2.5 years there, got traded to 76ers, who had the worst record in the league at the time. The following year, we came back, made the playoffs. I made the All-Star team that year, and just kind of moved forward in my career from there. That was in 2001, got traded to the Atlanta Hawks, played there. They had the worst record in the team. We had the best record in the team at the time that I was traded, and was actually a favorite. It was between us to win the East and to play the Lakers in the finals, which they end up doing, but not with me. They had traded me for Dikembe Mutombo. I had broken my wrist right at the beginning of the break for the All-Star, and I had just named starter for center for the All-Star team for the East Coast. And I broke my wrist, and they didn't think I would be able to come back, so they ended up trading me to the Hawks for Dikembe, and they went on to go to the finals that year, and that year they played against the Lakers. And the famous AI step over my man Tyronn Lue for the win for the first game of the finals that particular year. But did a lot of things within the NBA, accomplished a lot, known for being a shot blocker defender throughout my career, led the league 3 years in a row, finished top 15 in the history of block shots. And definitely enjoyed every minute of being in the NBA.
So Theo, in the last minute here, we'll pick up on the next question, but I wanted to talk a little bit more about the progress of the Celtics and maybe the problems that are going on potentially in Oklahoma City. We'll get to that in the next segment in about a couple of minutes or so. But anyway, Lenny, I'll tell you what, go ahead and get yourself a quick word in there. We got 40 seconds left.
Man, we'll just say this. Theo, man, you know when you walked in, player, you know I wanted to say that here comes the Sultan of SWAT, the monster of MASH, my boy known in the sports circus as the Block Party. So, man, we have got the Block Party. We got the Block Party in the house. All right, so we're going to be coming back with this, Theo, after the break here. Everybody in the sports circus going over a little bit of the Celtics. And pick our NBA player, pick his brain, and find out just what's real and what's fake news. So you're listening to the Sports Circus, and we'll be back in a few more minutes. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm Roy Firestone. Now it's time to throw it back to Sal.
My favorite one had to do with the Green Bay Packers. And I love the fact that they dealt off Ty Montgomery because of a blown assignment. Green Bay isn't Green Bay unless they have a good running game. Then they can win 10 Super Bowls. The fact is, you don't have a running game. You've got 70% passing, and that's not where Aaron Rodgers needs to be. He needs to be in a position where he's got a running game to offset the passing game and so forth. I like the move. Green Bay didn't have a running game anyway, so all they're doing is saying, we're going to get rid of you because you don't follow instructions.
Well, he made one of the most boneheaded plays I've ever seen. There's 2 minutes and 5 seconds on the clock. They traded him on Tuesday.
They should have cut him on Sunday
night. He shouldn't have been on the plane back to Green Bay.
Right, they should have made him walk back to Green Bay.
No, it was a terrible play. Now, he's not a stupid guy. He went to Stanford. Really? He's not a dumb guy,
but he doesn't follow instructions.
He made a terrible play.
The fact is, he didn't follow instructions. And you say he's not a dumb guy. His own agenda he put ahead of his team.
I agree.
Thus, he is a dumb guy, right or wrong?
Wrong. He just got selfish. You're not going to convince me that a guy from Stanford is a dum-dum.
No!
yeah, this is Sydney Justin from the Miracles.
So you heard yesterday's show at Roy Firestone. You think you heard a little clip about him going into the office where Smokey was at? And that was really good material, wasn't it?
Yeah, that was really funny, man.
Yeah, and then you heard him.
It was hilarious. It was cool, though. It was cool. Really cool story, man. I enjoyed listening to that.
Right, and then he gave a couple of bars. Can you give us a couple of more from Ooh Baby Baby? And let's see if you could do it better than Roy Firestone. Come on, man!
All right, you know what? Why not?
I did you wrong. My heart went out to play. But in the game, I lost you. What a price to pay. Hey, I'm crying. Ooh, baby, baby.
How's that, man?
That's
Is that okay? Is that good
man.
Enough?
That's incredible.
That's fantastic.
You know why? Because that's what you do. You're in the incredible business, Sid. That's awesome. Yes! Only at the Sports Circus. You're going to get sports. You get music.
Hey there, it's Nick Mackay. You may know me as the voice of Salem Saberhagen, the talking cat from Sabrina the Teenage Witch. You're listening to the Sports Circus. I'm on a... Calliope, get me out of here. I'm scared.
Hey,
Welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal here at Long Beach Landing. Colonel Bucky and a couple of cousins here, John and Dominic Tuzzolino from the greater Chicago area. Folks, make sure you follow us on our social media. That would be on Facebook and Twitter. And make sure you go to thesportscircus.com. Check us out. We're going to have a very new look in a couple of weeks. Lenny, tell them about your social media.
Yeah, you can reach me on Facebook at Lenny Adkins, A-D-K-I-N-S, and on Twitter, that would be Long Beach Lenny with the number 4 at the end of it.
All right. I'll put a round of applause for that. Lenny, before we get into basketball real quick, I got to tell you that we had a, believe it or not, hey, John, come here. You got to say this real quick. Hurry up. Come over here. And tell everybody who you saw. Speak into the microphone. Tell everybody who you saw today and what was it about?
Wow, I saw the great Pete Rose today. Pete Rose was he was selling his I think he was selling his autograph, but there was nobody there.
He was trying to peddle it and there was no taker.
You're peddling that autograph.
Not one taker, Theo. Not one.
He used to get some good money.
Yeah, well, that was then and that was then. All right. So anyway, there was a Pete Rose sighting, so we had to bring it up. Sorry. All right. So, Lenny, go ahead. And we start talking about OKC real quick. Go ahead and jump in there.
You know, one thing I wanted to just let Theo know. Theo, don't you think right now that the Celtics with Jason Tatum, don't you think that they got like their do-over with Len Bias with this kid? He reminds me so much of Len Bias. It looks like 30 years later they got their man.
Yeah, I mean, he's definitely very similar, but, I mean, I would not put him in the category right now, the great Len Bias. I mean, the things that Len Bias used to do in Maryland was, like, second to none. I mean, it was Michael Jordan-esque in college. You know what I mean? He was doing that in college, you know, the things that Jordan did after he came out of college. So I would give him that much right now, but he's definitely a great young player that's very smooth. And like I was telling somebody today, I was like, man, he's sneaky athletic because he goes in people's head too. When they least expect it, they think he's just a smooth finger roll type of guy, and then he'll turn around and dunk on your head. So he's definitely a very, very, very polished young player, and I think he's one of the best out of the draft right now.
Absolutely. Hey, you know what? We got somebody in the studio, a young man, Dominic, that wants to go ahead and throw a question at you. Go ahead, Dominic.
Okay. Hey, Theo. So
what's going on, man?
Kristaps Porzingis. So the Knicks, they're high up in the East standings. You think if he goes down, the Knicks are done?
Oh, without a question. I mean, anytime you have a guy that's off an MVP, you know, to go down on your team, if you don't have other MVPs on your team, then you can expect that. I mean, you look at Dallas Cowboys, Ezekiel Elliott. He's not playing. Look at what happens to him. They look like they don't even know how to play football no more. but then you look at, you know, a Porzingis, in a team that's definitely on the rise because of him and his attitude that he's taken this year, in which Phil Jackson was right. Carmelo was holding him back. so with Carmelo gone and people not really looking for Carmelo to be the guy and Carmelo trying to be the guy, now he's thrust into that position to being the guy and using those skills, that skill set that he's developed from overseas and now, you know, here in the NBA. And he's gotten a lot stronger and a lot more confidence in himself.
One more question. So with Kristaps being so dominant, do you think that just his performance has kind of had, like, other point guards in the leagues, do you think they're going to want to come to the Knicks, maybe come a championship-caliber team in the future?
Hold up now, hold up. It's still early in the season, young fella. it's still early in the season. I mean, you look at Cleveland. They're at the bottom of the barrel right now. They're not even in the playoff contention. But you think they're going to be there at the end of the season? Of course. I mean, it's still early in the season. I mean, what the Celtics is doing, you know, with their win streak and how they're playing, that's consistent basketball. But you know some of these other teams are going to get better just on talent and experience alone.
So, Theo,
Cleveland is going to grow.
Theo, let me ask you this.
At the same time, New York is a destination place. If New York can continue to strive, get to the playoffs, and show that consistency throughout the year, of course people are going to want to come here. I mean, it's New York City. I mean, of course.
So, Theo, let me ask you this. Do you believe the departure of Carmelo Anthony to OKC kind of loosened the crowd up, loosened up the way things are going in New York? I mean, let's face it, New York has basically been a doormat for how long? And I know John here, he's a really big anti-Knicks guy, right? Go ahead, jump in there.
Well, I mean, absolutely, because now there was no big expectation. I mean, you had Porzingis. Who else? I mean, they brought in, you know, Hardaway, who hasn't been a star. He's been a good player here, you know, in Atlanta, but he hadn't been a star, you know, on a team. And then you just got kind of role players. But I think the thing is they're playing through him now, whereas they were trying to play through Carmelo. And Carmelo had the big buzz of being who he is and being the New York guy and having that old regime behind him. You know, those old New Yorkers behind him. You know, being from the city area.
Yeah, I think the Knicks at the end of Carmelo's run, they were not behind him for at least the last 2 years. No, they were all tired of him.
No.
What makes you say that?
Yeah, but they didn't see that they couldn't see. They couldn't see the light at the end of the tunnel. They couldn't see, okay, you're going to trade Carmelo, but what are you going to get back for him? What did they get back for him? I mean, really.
They got back Enes Kanter. He's been putting up, you know, nice numbers. But,
right,
you know.
Right. You got a Kanter who's a very seasoned big man, you know, that knows and understands the game as well. So, but at the same time, I mean, when you quote-unquote Carmelo was a superstar once upon a time. He was a superstar. So you always got that cachet around him.
A superstar,
you know,
I mean, that can never
always,
win.
When you talked about the Knicks, you talked about Carmelo, you know, being there. But that was what the Achilles heel and Phil understood that. You know, he's not great for no reason. He's great because he understands what it takes in order to create and make a team and to be successful at a team. But he knew what Carmelo was doing because you see a lot of that same thing going on with the OKC struggle.
Yeah,
because
see,
I'm
like,
looking at him playing, and I'm like, you got Paul George, you got, my man Westbrook, and you're taking a big shot.
Yeah, they're not going to go.
I mean,
they're not going
to. The ball come to you. You're not looking to swing the ball back. You're trying to take the shot. And because the guy's playing you one-on-one and you've dominated, you feel like you still can do that. And you see them losing games at the end of the game. I don't even think they won a game where they've
all right, I'm going to hop in for one sec. I'm going to hop in for a sec. Carmelo Anthony is he's a plague, in my opinion. I think wherever he goes, whatever team he's going to be on, they're not going to succeed.
You're wrong.
They're never going to go. I'd say right now, the Oklahoma City Thunder, if they make the playoffs, they're losing in the first round. You can't have three ball dominant superstars on one team and expect to win.
They might.
It's called. You have to understand a role, and that's where he falls short in his career now, because he still thinks he can still be that star. He's taking more shots than anybody on the team. You can't do that. You're not that guy no more.
Well,
but he still tries to be that guy.
I think Carmelo Anthony still got it in him.
Well, you're right when you say
he's a pure shooter. That's his role.
Because if he don't understand that and take a lesser role, the team's not going to win because you can't win games anymore. You're not that guy.
Russell Westbrook, and he might just have to change his role, honestly. Like, he was just such a dominant. He wanted the ball all the time last season, but bringing Carmelo Anthony, he can't expect to just keep taking these shots when he's got other people. Like, he was taking shots with three guys on him. He might not have trusted someone like that was on the team last year, like Sabonis, to take a clutch shot. He now has like Carmelo Anthony and Paul George open when other people are coming on him. So he needs to pass the ball.
But what I'm saying is, if Carmelo is not the guy to take the last shots of the game, everybody has a certain rate. Like, during the game, people score, they do, just like I said about Kyrie. When it comes down to the fourth quarter, when it comes down to them last 5-6 minutes, the ball is going through Kyrie.
Okay.
Either he's going to shoot it or he's going to make the play.
You're right.
With OKC, you don't know who. And that's going to be an issue.
That is an issue because you got three guys that need the ball.
Carmelo's still trying to be that guy.
Right.
Because when the ball comes in at the last end of the game, he's shooting it. He's not looking to try to get it back to Westbrook or Paul George.
Right.
Who are better creators and scorers.
Hey, Theo.
He's going to do his little post-up turnaround phase. And he's not making it.
Theo, we're gonna go to break here in a second.
He's not making it. Plain and simple.
All right, we're going to be back here in just a few minutes on the Sports Circus. Folks, don't go anywhere. More to come.
Are you a small business owner or pursuing the dream of starting your own company? Do you know where to start or how to grow that existing business? The American Business Trust Company has the answers you need. The American Business Trust Company can help you with startup capital, business strategy, sales and marketing, and establishing your company with a physical location or on the internet. You decide. You bring the idea, the American Business Trust Company can help with the rest. For a free evaluation, you may visit them online at abtrustco.com. That's abtrustco.com, or call them at 657-600-1876. That's the American Business Trust Company, 657-600-1876. Call them today. They can help your business right away.
Attention business owners. You and your customers are listening to this commercial right now. Face it, every business needs customers, even yours. The Sports Circus is a primetime, nationally syndicated program that's carried on ABC, NBC, CNBC, and Westwood One News affiliates, plus CBS, Fox, and NBC Sports affiliates across North America, with coverage from Hawaii to New York. Also, the Sports Circus is available to the 180 million subscribers on iHeartRadio, and the Sports Circus gets about 4 million website visitors per month, which could click through your website and bring sales. The Sports Circus provides great content featuring celebrity guests from sports and entertainment to our audience every weekday, which your company could greatly benefit from by increasing your visibility, foot traffic, eyeballs to your website, and calls from potential customers. Call us right now at 702-799-9935. Again, 702-799-9935, or email us at info@thesportscircus.com. That's info@thesportscircus.com. Drive your sales today by advertising with the Sports Circus.
That's the sound of sizzling, dry-aged USDA Prime Wagyu and Angus steaks from UppercutChops.com. They're best-in-class filet mignons, New York steaks, and the king of all steaks, the tomahawk and cowboy cut ribeyes, are the best in the business. Even their Prime Wagyu burgers will likely be the best you've ever had. Browse the full selection of steaks and chops at UppercutChops.com from the comfort of your home or on your mobile device. UppercutChops.com delivers all-natural, dry-aged USDA Prime Wagyu and Angus steaks and chops directly to your door. Without the hassle of going to the grocery store and fight crowds to pick from a small selection of average and best meats with injected steroids, fillers, and coloring added to look good. Find out what's for dinner at UppercutChops.com or call 702-799-9935. That's 702-799-9935. 702-799-9935. Or make your selection directly at UppercutChops.com.
Hey, this is Tommy John, and you're listening to the Sports Circus.
We'll be right back. Okay, folks, welcome back to the Sports Circus. I'm your Ringmaster Sal here with Long Beach Lenny and Colonel Bucky. We also have a couple of student athletes here, and also Theo Ratliff, our NBA correspondent, 16-year veteran, three-time Shop Blocking champion, is with us as well. Folks, make sure you follow us on social media. And also, hey, Theo, how can everybody get a hold of you on social media?
You get a hold of me by going to Shot Blocker. Or Shot Blocker on Instagram, Shot Blocker 42 on Facebook. And that's pretty much how you get a hold of me.
What else would it be? Shot Blocker? I mean, really? That's exactly what I expect from you. I think, isn't your favorite phrase, get it up out of here?
Get it up out of here.
That's the one. Hey, you know, guys, he's also one of Shaquille O'Neal's clausifers, Shaka Claus. Tell everybody about that.
It's coming up soon, man. That's my guy, man. Love going out with Shaq and giving the gifts out to the kids. I mean, it's a beautiful time of the year for sure.
That's a great cause. All right, so hey, Dominic's got a quick question for you, and it's not related to the other teams. He's a Wizards guy. So let Dominic get in there. You know, Dominic plays center as well.
Okay.
Go ahead, get in there.
Hey, so the Wizards last year, they made it to the playoffs, something kind of unexpected. John Wall kind of carrying the team. Do you think that they might be able to get back and make it a little bit farther this year?
Oh, that was unexpected? I think you look at John Wall and Bill. I mean, you look at two of the best two combination guards in the league, you know, defensively and offensively. I mean, and then with Porter coming on the way he's coming on and good attack, and then the young fellow is playing well. What's his name? Kansas? You know what I'm talking about. They're playing at the three.
Oh, it's right at the tip of my tongue. Two.
Yes.
You're talking about Kelly Oubre?
Yeah, Oubre. Oubre is doing an excellent job. He's grown leaps and bounds since last year.
Oh, yeah.
And like I said, that's the key on taking that next step. You got to have more guys to be able to step up and have that confidence and show that, you know, on the floor. And that's why, you know, you see those guys, you know, having success again and really, really looking at talent at Eastern Conference.
All right. Any more questions, Dom? Or you want to throw it over to John real quick? Hey, you know what? Theo, John's got another question for you because he's really fired up about this. He's been talking about he thinks that Porzingis is not really a good player. He thinks he sucks.
It's not that I think he sucks. He is not.
I know, exactly. Are you out of your mind?
Absolutely not.
Hold on a second. We got something for you.
What are you people?
On dope? Don't let him put them words in your mouth.
Yeah, absolutely not. What my end of things here is that, yeah, sure, Porzingis is a great prospect coming in, but the Knicks are a dumpster fire. Sure, their record right now is a fluke. Watch. Give them a month. They'll be at least 10 games under 500. Porzingis can't keep up
what he's been doing right now. Where's the currency of the Sports Circus? Oh, grab that real quick.
Yeah, here it is.
All right, so Theo, this is the currency of the Sports Circus, Theo. It is a bag of red vines. Since we don't bet money, we don't want to do that. It's the sweet-smelling, artificially flavored red vines. Yes, red vines, US money.
Oh.
Yes, so we bet bags and cases of red vines. So John over here was just saying they're a dumpster fire, which I thoroughly believe New York just in general is. But I will say that the New York Knicks will not be 10 games under 500 in 1 month. Care to wager a bag of red vines? John?
Sure, deal.
Deal, yeah. All right. Deal. He shakes on it.
Listen, how many teams, and this will answer your question right here. How many teams in the East had a significance of a guy that's 7'2" that can play outside and inside?
I think of the name Joel Embiid with the Sixers. Sure, I am a Celtics fan, there's one right there for you, Joel Embiid.
That's what I'm saying.
That's one!
When you have a dominant guy, and that's why Philly is going to, we can talk about them too, that's why Philly...
Yeah, you know, there's another guy, sure, he may not be 7'2", but Giannis Antetokounmpo, complete beast. complete beast.
No, totally different, different player.
I agree with you, Theo.
Okay.
Get in there, kid.
Give him hell. You're saying a guy that can play outside and inside. No one, sure, he's not 7'2", but he's looking like an MVP caliber player.
Who can stop Kristaps?
As long as Porzingis can dominate the game the way he's dominated the game, the Knicks will win in the East.
I still don't buy it.
And they'll give a lot of people problems because you can't guard him with a small guy. And you can't guard him with a big guy because he's going to run y'all picks and everything else and shoot 3 points.
Fear the unicorn.
So he's a unicorn. So that's the part that was being kind of held back with Carmelo because the dog is stagnant. And then you have veteran guys now with a Jack, a Lee, a role players that's going to let him play his role. Be the dominant guy, get us the lead, dominate the game, and everybody play off of you. And they have good enough players to with a harder way and those guys that's getting better and coming on and some of the young guys that they drafted that can play those roles and still win in the East. Now, going out west, I mean, he might have a few talents.
They're not going to win for at least 5 years. The Knicks won't be in the playoffs for the next 5 years. I just don't see it happening. You're going to give Tim Hardaway Jr. the lucrative amount of money that they gave him. He's not going to make that big of a difference. Sure, the guy could score, but you need to go out there and get other free agents that are actually going to put up important and big numbers.
He's already making a difference. And what the GMs do, they try to get a guy young enough to where he can grow. And you see the potential. You see from where he came as a rookie, and you see his progression through those years. That's why they paid him the money, because they've seen his progression, and he's only getting better. So they're looking for big things from him.
Theo, in 5 years,
they're looking for him to be that sidekick with a person.
They may be.
And he has the ability to be able to do that.
They will certainly be a playoff team in 5 years, Theo. In 5 years, I believe that. John over here, he's been drinking a Kool-Aid. I don't know. It's not going to happen. No, I think they will. No, I think they will be. John over here doesn't think so. He's drinking the Kool-Aid. Now, Dominic, really? On the other hand, Dominic thinks they will be a playoff team in 5 years, right or wrong?
Come on, man.
I don't know about the Knicks being a playoff team, but
are you looking at the rest
Kristaps to the Wizards. All I got to say is Kristaps to the Wizards.
Come on, man.
Are you looking at the rest of the Heat?
Well, you know what's going to happen, Theo? Porzingis may end up getting traded to Chicago, to my hometown Bulls, and we actually may have something to root for a change. Right,
you see what the Bulls are. The Bulls tanking.
Well, I know. We'll trade a general manager for him. We'll trade the GM for him. We don't need him. Hell no, we don't need him. That's all right.
They didn't win it through the process, but I mean, you see how the East is going, man. I mean, there's no reason why New York wouldn't make the playoffs.
I know. That's what I was saying. They absolutely will make the playoffs within 5 years. Dominic says the same. John over here says he says no. John says absolutely no. I say they'll do it within 3 years.
Oh, New York?
Yeah. They'll be a playoff team in 3 years.
They'll make the playoffs this year.
I know. That's what I'm saying. This guy over here, he's
saying in 5 years.
Well, he was saying 5 years. He said they wouldn't even do it in 5 years.
Oh, wow.
Come on, man.
Oh, yeah.
Come on.
You got to watch the game.
I know. He's not watching the games. What do you think? Jump in here, Dom.
There's no Dom. Everybody went to the West. All the major players went to the West.
Come back to me when
it gets up. So there's only everybody's in the process like Sixers was now. They're in the process. They're trying to get not free agents, they're trying to get draft picks
right
to help build their team.
Well, John, I don't know if you're telling the truth because every time we play 2K, you always want to be Tim Hardaway.
Oh, is that what it is?
That's what it is.
2K is completely different than the actual NBA. If Tim Hardaway Jr. is going to get $60 plus million in the actual NBA, he's not going to be on my team in 2K. Absolutely not.
And he just dropped the mic.
Oh, wow.
All right. Hey, listen, Theo.
Well, I think that's like the average rate now just for role players.
I know. I'll be the water boy for $10 million. That's okay.
So he might be getting underplayed, in about a year.
All right. Hey, Theo, we're gonna wrap up the segment here. I wanted to thank you for joining us today, as always. And I tell you what, man, I'll give you a call over the holiday weekend. How's that?
Yeah, man, I appreciate it. Always good to talk to you guys. Always enjoy.
All right.
The commentary and the thoughts. And the young fellas that came in, y'all keep on doing what you're doing, being great, and having that confidence. Confidence is everything.
Hey, it was a pleasure, Theo.
Yeah, thanks, Theo.
All right, Theo.
Talk to you.
All right, folks, that was Theo Ratliff, our 16-year veteran NBA. Wow. Our three-time shot-blocking champion in the NBA. For 16 years, he played on a bunch of different teams. And, folks, let me tell you, he was a good one. Make sure you look him up and follow him on social media. That would be Shot Blocker. I believe that was on Instagram and also on Facebook as well.
I know what the big deal about Cracker Jack is. Did you ever go and buy a pack of Cracker Jack thinking you're going to get a prize and find no prize in the box? Here's the pitch. That might not sound important to some people, but when you're a little kid, especially from humble origin, and they cheat you out of a prize, there's a bouncing ball. Second baseman has the Barbary over to first. It's hard to think in laudatory terms of the product.
I take it there was an occasional box of Cracker Jacks that found no prizes for the little Harry Carey many years ago.
You got that right. And boy, when a box of Cracker Jack to me meant a lot of money. Here's a pitch, bounce foul. That's the most asinine marketing I've ever heard of. One ball, one strike. These guys say, well, you sing about Cracker Jack. I said that I only sing it because it's in the song. Here's a pitch, foul back. And I wouldn't be a bit surprised, even to this day, some youngsters who buy a box of Cracker Jack don't find a prize in the box. One ball, two strikes, two out. Well, if you're going to talk about our congressman being crooked, here's a pitch foul out of play. Why not talk about commercial products that don't do what they represent to do? High pop fly. That one be a home run in a phone booth. Can't beat fun at the old ballpark, friends.
There's a drive way back. It might be. It could be.
This crowd is wild.
Hey, everybody. This is Barry Katz from the Industry Standard Podcast, and you're listening to the Sports Circus with Sal Tuzzolino.